Good afternoon and welcome to the second of our sessions on the legacies of the Great War. This is an ongoing symposium sponsored by the History Department, the School of Law, the Gender and Sexuality Resources Center, and Women's and Gender Studies Program. This afternoon, it's a pleasure to welcome you all because this is a very special event today. Not only is it the second session in our symposium, but it's also the occasion of our 12th annual Reverend Henry Casper Lecture, which is offered by the History Department annually. The Casper Lectures are funded by an endowment established by one of Father Casper's former students, Dr. Wayne Ryan, president of Streck Laboratories in Omaha. Both Dr. Ryan and his brother Don were Father Casper's students when he formerly taught at Creighton before he came to Marquette. Each year, Dr. Ryan's endowment brings to campus a distinguished scholar in fields other than American history, since Father Casper himself was a historian of Europe, a student of the Second French Empire. Father Casper was born in Milwaukee in 1908. He attended St. Rose of Lima School right over here in Merrill Park and Marquette Academy. And from there, he entered the Society of Jesus in 1927, completing his BA and his MA at St. Louis University. Did his studies for the priesthood at St. Mary's College in Kansas and was ordained in 1943, and then went on to complete the licentiate in theology and the doctorate in history at Catholic University of America. He taught at Creighton for much of his career and rose there to dean of the graduate school and came to Marquette in 1964, completing his career here. He remained active until his death, serving as director of development of the Catholic League for Religious and Civil Rights and assisting in pastoral work at St. Monica's Parish in Whitefish Bay. His students remember Father Casper as an engaging teacher at both Creighton and Marquette. He was a demanding master of the classroom, too, and he once said to me with a chuckle, "The students used to call me the Black Death, you know." Whatever the student nickname, and I think all of us who stand in front of a classroom probably know deep down we all have one, the lessons Father Casper taught were valuable ones that contributed to his students' success in the academy and beyond its walls. That is why Dr. Ryan provided this lecture in his honor. Our Casper lecturer today is Dr. Leonard V. Smith, the Frederick B. Arts Professor of History at Oberlin College. He is one of the country's preeminent specialists on the First World War, a conflict whose centenary we observe this year. Professor Smith is the author of four major books, including Between Mutiny and Obedience, the case of the 5th French Infantry Division during World War I, France and the Great War, 1914-1918, which he co-edited with Stéphane Audouin-Rousseau and Annette Becker. The third book is The Embattled Self, French Soldiers' Testimony of the Great War. And he's got forthcoming now Sovereignty at the Paris Peace Conference of 1919, Laboratory Over a Vast Cemetery. In addition, he's edited Vichy France and the Historians and has contributed to several of the major collaborative studies published this year in observance of the war's centenary, including the Cambridge History of the First World War. The international recognition of his scholarship is evident in his appointment as Distinguished Visiting Professor at the University of Paris 7, the Associated Kyoto Program of Dashishi University in Kyoto, Japan, Claremont McKenna College, and the École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales in Paris, that is the School for Advanced Studies in the Social Sciences in Paris. This spring, he'll be visiting scholar at the Mershon Center for International Security Studies at The Ohio State University. His subject today is the war after the war, drawing boundaries at the Paris Peace Conference. Please join me in welcoming Professor Smith.
Thank you so much, and thank you so much for turning out on a cold gray day. It's been my pleasure to visit Milwaukee a number of times, but this is my first time at Marquette, and it's a great pleasure to be here. I should also say that I'm on leave and kind of out of my operatic lecturing voice. So if you can't hear me, please give a shout or throw something or something like that. Okay. It's become a bit of a growth industry among historians of the First World War to put the world back into the war, showing how it was a genuinely global conflict rather than a European civil war that dragged in various non-Europeans. But I'm not always sure, I think this is a good thing, but I'm not always sure it's done in the most reflective manner possible. We're seeing this year, I think especially, assertion after assertion after assertion that the world was really there before during and after the Great War without much thinking about what the world meant in this context. I guess I have to count myself among those who believe that the Great War really was, at its core, a European war in its causes and its outcomes. That's why, truth be told, as a historian, I use the term Great War more commonly than World War I, in part to distinguish it from World War II, which in fundamentally different ways, I think, was a global conflict. But the Great War was also a world war in the ways it set in motion and fostered huge changes in what the world meant. And it's around this issue that I would like to position my talk today. And I'd like to take just one of the world's present-day trouble spots and show its connections to the outcome of World War I, and that being Syria, which, as Professor's introduction shows, has absolutely nothing to do with my former work. But, you know, one of the things about getting older is that you get to do what you want. And I am loving this project. I'm loving taking on a new sort of challenge, you know, and it'll get done. So I need to confess to you that plan A for this lecture was to discuss three of the world's trouble spots: Syria, Iraq, and Ukraine. This proved so complicated it would probably keep us all here all night. Plan B was to discuss just Syria and Iraq, but that would keep us here well into the evening. So we're on plan C, which takes us just to Syria. Syria alone is so ungodly complicated that this is probably an example of a fool rushing in where angels fear to tread. But I guess that's why God invented tenure. So here goes. Okay. My talk is entitled The War After the War. The common dates of the First World War are, of course, 1914 to 1918. But the war did not actually end in 1918 in Syria, just as it did not end in 1918 in various other present-day trouble spots, among them Iraq and Ukraine. And what I'm going to argue is that the struggles to draw boundaries in Syria are part and parcel of the war itself, and that they are part of the war after the war. So, as Julian indicated, my talk draws from a bigger project on the locus and attributes of sovereignty at the Paris Peace Conference of 1919, charged with ending the war. What sort of historically specific international system did that conference create? What were the actors within that system? What motivated them? And what did it mean to rule over and within that system? So I also want to thank you all in advance for letting me try some of this stuff out before you. Drawing boundaries was, certainly after the First World War, was never about literally, in this case, drawing lines in the sand. It was about assigning sovereignty. It was about deciding nations and the identities of peoples who lived in nations. And in creating an international system that sought to normalize self-determined nation states, drawing a boundary made a statement about the people who lived within that boundary. Okay? So, consequently and ideologically speaking, the Paris Peace Conference tried to mix old-time power politics and the new diplomacy of Wilsonianism. That is to say, 19th century great power politics in which the powers sort of did what they were permitted to do, and this world of self-determined, preferably democratic nation states, most commonly associated with the American president, Woodrow Wilson. And in trying to reconcile these two very different ways of organizing the world, the Wilsonian world and the great power politics way of organizing the world, the conference created a world it could not really control, and thus hardwired problems in the international system that we're still living with. And I'm going to spin out one of these cases today. Okay, then we need to start with the Ottoman Empire, which was allied with Germany during World War I. And this is a map of the Ottoman Empire in 1914, of course, comprised today's Turkey, but also present-day Syria, Lebanon, Israel, Jordan, Palestine, parts of Saudi Arabia, Iraq. And what I want to call your attention to are the two fingers kind of running down this way of the Ottoman Empire along the Persian Gulf and along the Red Sea. Essentially, from here on down, from present-day Syria and Iraq on down, was majority Arab-speaking. So the next question is, what exactly do we mean by Syria? What does Syria mean? And this is kind of the big question from the time of the Romans to the Ottomans, down to ISIS or ISIL or IS or whatever the acronym is nowadays. What is the demarcated geographic space here? The Romans used the term Syria to indicate the lands of the Roman Empire between Anatolia and Egypt. That's what Syria meant to the Romans. That is, present-day Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Israel, Palestine, with bits of Turkey, probably Saudi Arabia, and Iraq thrown in, depending on who you ask. Under the Ottoman Empire, Syria was part of what Westerners called Turkey in Asia, and this is a 1909 English map indicating that. It's appropriate in this context to think of Syria as an isthmus, something that connects eastern Anatolia to the Ottoman domains in the Arabian Peninsula and in Mesopotamia, what would become Iraq. And this isthmus, Syria as isthmus, was bounded on one side by water, by the Mediterranean Sea, the other by desert. And of what was commonly thought of as Syria as an isthmus. And this red line is a railroad. Note that it runs north-south, primarily. Okay, much like the trade routes. Now, see on the next map, the Ottomans had a variety of administrative districts, sanjaks and vilayets, but they weren't really political boundaries in a modern sense. They were areas, they were demarcated administrative districts for raising taxes and raising troops. And that's really what the Ottoman Empire wanted from its peoples, particularly its non-Turkish speaking peoples. The Ottomans didn't really expect people to identify much with their vilayet or their sanjak. And wouldn't that point to the problem in Syria from that day to this? At its origin, Syria described geography and Roman and Ottoman administrative convenience rather than people. The problem comes when nations and states are supposed to express the organization of peoples. They're supposed to be the form, the political form a people takes. Once that becomes the issue, where is Syria and who are Syrians? Who are the Syrians who live there? The question this begs, of course, is what makes a nation a nation? Okay. In Europe, most of the time, what it gets down to is some sort of cultural definition, often reduced to language and religion. Importing this concept of nationhood, national identity as being rooted in language and religion is going to cause a lot of problems in any kind of version of Syria as it existed at the beginning of the 20th century. Arabic, the Arabic language is a common denominator, sort of. Language, of course, is perhaps a necessary but insufficient condition for nationhood, particularly in a highly diverse society in which business would regularly be transacted in three or four or even more languages, as was the case in much of the Ottoman world. Trying to use religion as a national glue is going to create many, many more problems than it would solve. There were communities representing all three of the world's great monotheistic faiths there before 1914, Judaism, Christianity, although of course the vast majority were of the Islamic faith. But saying that all three great monotheistic faiths were present, in fact, seriously understates the religious diversity of geographic Syria at the time of World War I, however you decide to draw the boundaries. There were Sunni, Shiite Muslims. Sunnis were a small majority in most estimates. There were the Alawis and the Druze, regionally powerful sects that were offshoots of the Shiites. The El Assad family, which currently runs, or rather misruns, Syria, though secular in creed, are from the Alawites. There were Greek and Syrian Eastern Orthodox churches, five kinds of uniate Catholic churches with some sort of link to Rome, and at least three additional Christian sects beyond that, as well as both Sephardic and Ashkenazi Jews. Now, this diversity really didn't matter that much to the Ottomans. What the Ottomans wanted were tribute, troops, and trade. That was pretty much it. Empires, by definition, are about difference, and they're about the hierarchical management of difference among peoples, ruling diverse peoples through subordinations. Nations are about the establishment of communities. Okay? Well, come the disintegration of Ottoman authority in 1918, what exactly is supposed to happen in what had been geographic Syria? What does a Syrian nation look like? What is Syria? Who are the Syrians? Well, the military powers in the region, Britain and France, thought that they knew what to do with Syria. And they had a script, really straight out of 19th century imperialism. Carve it up, run the place like imperial domains. This was the hallmark of what was called the old diplomacy. Right? Britain and France both had their reasons for making these plans for Syria. For one thing, and I think this is often forgotten, Britain and France were not at all sure until very late in the war that the war on the Western Front was going to end in victory. There was considerable doubt well into the summer of 1918 that this war was going to have a successful outcome on the Western Front. Okay, and both, and for different reasons, both were sure that they were going to need something to show for this horrible war, in most probably in the form of some sort of conquest in the Middle East. For the French, for their part, had what today seems an almost irrational devotion to acquiring what would become present-day Lebanon and present-day Syria. There were non-trivial trade links, particularly with what became Lebanon. And of all things, Crusader mythology was very important. It was something that the French colonial lobby took in fact quite seriously. And of France and various agreements that go back to the monarchy, that the monarchy had made with the Ottoman authorities as with France as the protector of the Christian populations there. So the links to Christian-dominated Lebanon, or present-day Lebanon, was at the heart of what the French wanted in the region. There was also this idea of a kind of French Mediterranean, which would unite the southern coast of France, Corsica, Morocco, Tunisia, other French imperial territories. I guess kind of worked as well as anything in the far-flung French Empire, much of which geographically is actually the Sahara. Here. The French really kind of, after the 18th century, they kind of had a knack for going for where the resources weren't. You know? And, whatever the French Empire was about, I think it may have been about personal fortunes, but it wasn't really about making much money for France. Although certain French could do very well off it indeed. In fact, the French premier during the Paris Peace Conference, Georges Clemenceau, who you've no doubt heard of, was actually pretty contemptuous of empire. He thought it was a gigantic waste of money if the real threat to France was from Germany. But even he had to recognize the importance of the colonial lobby. The British Empire, come on, there we go, the British Empire always claimed global strategic interests, as you can see on the map. But the British Empire had this other aspect that I want to bring out here, a second center of power in addition to the British Isles. And this was the white-ruled government of India, Europeans sent by Westminster to rule what, according to the BBC series of many years ago, called the jewel in Britain's imperial crown. The government of India is a very interesting enterprise, and I think sometimes underestimated in thinking about Britain as a global power. The government of India was basically a bunch of white guys who ruled in the name of the Emperor of India, who happened to be the same person as the king of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, I'm sorry, Ireland at the time, George V. Okay? But the government of India was more its own creature than one might think. In fact, was very good, very capable at asserting its own interest in relation to the government in Westminster. Because of the Suez Canal, right here in the British Protectorate of Egypt, the government of India was automatically interested in what happened in the Middle East and in affairs of the Middle East. In fact, the government of India had a huge interest in the defeat of the Ottoman Empire in the Great War, and as part of an ever-expanding idea of just what it meant to protect access to India. And this is a common theme of 19th century imperialism. You keep expanding more and more and more to secure what you already have. And that's kind of the intriguing, one of the intriguing questions of European imperialism, like how much is enough? And I think Cecil Rhodes once said, I would annex the stars if I could. I don't know what that means, but it was a very kind of Cecil Rhodes thing to say that I think does speak to something about motivations. Indeed, so important was winning the war against the Ottoman Empire that the British made a great many contradictory promises in order to do so. There was a 1915 correspondence between Sir Henry McMahon and the Emir Hussein of Mecca, the point being to encourage an Arab revolt against the Ottomans in the Arabian Peninsula. McMahon was the British High Commissioner in Egypt. The gist of the correspondence was that in exchange for the Arabs rising against the Ottomans, the British would recognize the quote-unquote independence of the lands east of the coastal areas. Okay. To make a long story short, this correspondence also raised as many questions as it answered. Did the High Commissioner of Egypt speak for the whole British government, its London and Delhi branches? What exactly would happen in these strategic coastal areas? What, in any event, would independence mean? And what about the Allies, particularly the French, who the British really needed to win the war in Europe, in fact, needed a lot more than they needed the Arabs? Which brings us to the second set of promises made, which was to the French. In the form of an agreement between two relatively junior officials, they weren't that junior, but they weren't running the show either, Mark Sykes of Great Britain and Georges Picot of France in May 1916, the Sykes-Picot Agreement. Approved of by the respective foreign ministries, but not a formal treaty. In fact, it was a secret agreement, but a secret agreement that became public because the loyal Russian allies had been sent a copy. Well, come the revolution in Russia in 1917, the Bolsheviks broke open the Tsar's archives and began publishing all sorts of dirty little secrets, the Sykes-Picot Agreement being among them. Under the Sykes-Picot Agreement, Roman and Ottoman Syria would be divided. And this is the main point, okay? And there are two maps here. This is the kind of hand-drawn version from the British archives. And it indicates a British zone of direct rule in what became Iraq, a French zone of direct rule extending into Anatolia, two zones, a B zone and an A zone of indirect rule, and then an international zone in Palestine. Bless the heart of the BBC. Here's a more user-friendly version, which shows the same thing, the respective spheres of influence. Very standard 19th century style carve-up, okay? So then a bit more about the international zone in Palestine, which brings us to the third set of promises. There we go. To the Jews of the world, in the form of the Balfour Declaration of November 1917. Contrary to popular belief, the Balfour Declaration never promised a Jewish state. What it did promise was support of the British government for a Jewish homeland in Palestine. And there was a fair amount of calculated vagueness in the document. And it promised British government support for a Jewish homeland in Palestine as long as it didn't disrupt the people who already lived there. Okay. Good luck with that. Talk about a scotch and milk cocktail. The reasons behind the Balfour Declaration are very complicated. Certainly there was a genuine interest in helping the Jews of the world, the idea that they would never truly be safe until they had a homeland of their own. The British were especially interested in establishing that homeland, a homeland beholden to the British, wouldn't you know, right next door to the Suez Canal. So what real estate agents always say, location, location, location. Okay. So three sets of contradictory promises by the British. Now the matter actually gets complicated. Okay. There was an indigenous Arab nationalist movement handsomely subsidized by the British under the Emir of Mecca, Hussein bin Ali, who had two sons, Abdullah and Faisal. of the Hashimi clan, also known as the Hashemites. And these were very prominent people. They were direct descendants of the Prophet Muhammad and were, under the Ottomans, they were the religious leaders and the religious protectors of the sites of Mecca, the holiest sites of Islam. That's the good news in a way. The bad news from this point of view is that Mecca is in the Arabian Peninsula, not far from the Red Sea, and quite a good distance indeed from Syria, and that's part of the problem. With British support, the Hashemites led the Arab revolts against the Ottomans beginning in 1916. Hussein's son Faisal, shown here in the middle, this is a very famous picture, led the Arab forces, although I'm afraid his English advisor, T.E. Lawrence, had a much better publicist. He becomes known as Lawrence of Arabia and ends up getting a lot of the credit in David Lean's film, I guess. Who plays Faisal? Do you remember who plays Faisal? Oh, it's Alec Guinness. Okay. Oh, thank you. Lawrence gets a lot of the credit in the English-speaking world. Okay. Well, the war won. What happens? Okay, the Ottomans are defeated. We build something. What is it that we're going to build? The Hashemite house wants most some sort of pan-Arab solution. In its grandest versions, pan-Arab aspirations call for a single federation of Arabic-speaking peoples from Iraq through North Africa to Morocco. And this, too, as I'm sure many of you know, is a recurrent dream. Nasser of Egypt, Saddam Hussein, even ISIL has its own kind of version of this, but something uniting all of these peoples. Okay, but the whole question of what the proper political unit is in the post-Ottoman Middle East is a good place to introduce the next complication. Okay, which comes most prominently through the American president, Woodrow Wilson. The United States, by the way, had never declared war on the Ottoman Empire, so it was in the odd situation of contributing to the making of peace in a part of the world where it had actually never made war. But the American president's vision was so expansive, it wasn't such a leap to think that the U.S. was going to be involved in making the peace. Now, the manifesto for creating the new international order came in the form of an address to Congress in January 1918, known as the 14-point speech. It did not actually call for the dismemberment of the Ottoman Empire. Rather, point 12 of 14 stipulated that the non-Turkish peoples of the empire, quote, should be assured an undoubted security of life and an absolutely unmolested opportunity for autonomous development, unquote. It's not very complicated syntax. I think kind of unnecessarily complicated syntax. But he was apparently, he was really quite a wonderful speaker. It was complicated syntax. This was, it should be noted, perhaps more complicated, or I'm sorry, less new than it claimed to be. Even the Sykes-Picot Agreement, and I just learned this a couple days ago, claimed that Britain and France, quote, are prepared to recognize and protect an independent Arab state or confederation of Arab states under the suzerainty of an Arab chief. And so this uneasy encounter between self-determination and empire actually began before Wilson, but it was really Wilson that made it this global phenomenon. In other words, this self-determination thing was not just the dream of an idealistic American president who was an ex-college professor named Woodrow Wilson. The British and the French, in fact, issued their own declaration on the 7th of November, 1918, just days before the war ended on the Western Front. I quote, "Far from wishing to impose on those populations any particular institutions, they," that is the British and the French, "are concerned only to ensure by their support and by adequate assistance the regular workings of governments and administrations freely chosen by the populations themselves." The British and the French said this publicly to the whole world days before the armistice on the Western Front. Okay, so what happens then when you get to the peace conference? What happens next? Well, the assumption was that the Arabic-speaking former Ottoman realms would be governed provisionally as mandates under the League of Nations. And the mandate was a provisional kind of external rule until such time as the peoples who lived there were deemed fit to govern themselves. It was a kind of a tutelage, a kind of educational external rule. It's very common to dismiss the mandates as colonial rule under another name, as a fig leaf to grab new territories. And that was perhaps the intent, and to some extent what they were, or at least what they became. The British, the French, the Japanese empires knew how to function in certain ways. They functioned with armies, they functioned with bureaucrats, at least the European empires functioned with missionaries, and that's kind of how they worked, whether they were called territories, protectorates, or mandates. But I think there was more to it than that. The mandates, by definition, at least Class A and Class B mandates, and we can talk about what that means later if you like, had a sell-by date. They didn't say what the sell-by date was, but they were deemed to be temporary rule. The world was told from the outset that the mandate wasn't supposed to be forever. Okay? It differed greatly, therefore, from being the Emperor of India. There were supposed to be emperors of India forever, or so the British thought. Okay? The British Empire was supposed to be about forever. The mandates were not supposed to be about forever, and they were designed that way. Okay. And this was, in fact, written into the covenant of the League of Nations, with which all five treaties of the five treaties produced by the Paris Peace Conference, all of them had the Covenant of the League of Nations as a preamble, and they all referred specifically to the non-Turkish speaking parts of the former Ottoman Empire and to rule being particularly provisional there. So I would argue then that the whole mandate system, perhaps contrary to the intentions of at least some of those who set it up, was in fact a dagger at the heart of empire, whether it met the desires of the powers who signed the treaty or not. It was real hard to make sense of empire if you accepted the principle of the mandates. Why should the Arabs of Syria or the Arabs of Iraq get self-determination sooner rather than later? Whereas the Arabs of Egypt, let alone the Arabs, the Arabs of Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco, get it at some undetermined point in the future, or never. Excuse me. So I would argue that the whole imperial enterprise began to look weirder and weirder once the imperial powers themselves accepted the principle of the mandate. Okay. Now, there were at the time various schemes to preserve Syria as a geographic unit under a single mandate. excuse me. Schemes that began with recognizing that in fact there were all sorts of peoples mixed in together in this region, and it was going to be really hard to disentangle them. Okay. The French had one such plan. Okay. And I'm sorry that this isn't in better focus. I don't know that it would make much more sense if it were in focus. Okay. This was a map drawn by a very famous French geographer by the name of Augustin Bernard. And I can't, you know, and this map comes from that. Bernard, and he was part of the Comité d'études, the sort of a think tank that the French government set up to begin planning for the peace. And Bernard wrote a whole piece about Syria. And in Bernard's words, he wrote, "It is by religion that the inhabitants of Syria are classified. It is by religion that the inhabitants of Syria are classified." An equation, essentially, of race and religion, or at least nationality and religion. And what this map is an imposition of a kind of French Cartesian certainty over the demographic religious diversity of Syria. The shaded areas indicate the majority religions, the stripes indicate the various religious minorities, and these are kind of divided up into things that sort of look like squares that don't seem to correspond to administrative districts. I'm not really sure what they do correspond to. I think maybe Bernard might have invented them for the occasion. They don't seem to be the Ottoman boundaries. The strength of the shade indicates the numerical strength of the majority, and vice versa. The stronger the color, the stronger the majority. The weaker the color, the weaker the majority. And the same with stripes. The stripes change in hue also. There we go. The key. Okay. It's hard to read this, but it's green is Muslims of Arabic language. Purple is Turks and Kurds who are mixed together, which is interesting. Let's see, yellow is Druze, orange is Christian, brown is Armenians, and blue is Jews. Okay. And all this, it should be noted, was based on no precise knowledge of who lived where. And that's a really interesting thing about studying this. They're making all these judgments and all these plans. Nobody had any idea. And by the way, they didn't have a much better idea in Europe. It's not like they knew who was where in Europe and didn't in Syria. They didn't know anywhere. They were pulling this all out of their hats. Bernard himself admitted in an appendix to his report that he used pre-war sources, mostly from the Ottoman regime, which he explicitly distrusts. He was particularly convinced that they had radically understated the Christian population. Ironically, and this is true of the British documents as well, there are also all sorts of German sources, you know, because there was nothing else, you know. And this, you know, none of these pre-war sources, even had they been trustworthy, a question on which I remain agnostic, I have no idea whether they're trustworthy or not, but I do know that they didn't allow for the massive population dislocations that happened during the war, to say nothing of a really bad famine that happened during the war throughout Syria. And this appendix notes almost in passing that in Lebanon proper, he estimates that Lebanon lost some 200,000 of its 500,000 inhabitants. By the way, but nevertheless, he comes up with a map of this precision. The moral of his story, though, is actually quite interesting, that the diversity of this is such that in the long run, you couldn't demarcate national communities within this space. The only answer is to make all of Syria one secularized, economically integrated whole. In other words, to put a greater Syria under the extended tutelage of a secular Western power. Gee, do you think Bernard had any particular power in mind? No? Okay. Well, it was, of course, France. Well, Bernard was also aware of the Sykes-Picot Agreement by that time. His report was published in 1919. And he held the kind of touching concern that British concerns could be for access to India could be allowed through the continuation of the wartime alliance. The British would sort of let the French run the place and they'd be okay with that. The Balfour Declaration was not even mentioned, was not even on the radar screen. Now, the gist of this, of Bernard's prescription of a secular large Syria was reflected or reproduced in a better known set of recommendations that came from what became known as the King Crane Commission. The original plan had been to send an inter-allied commission to the Middle East to make recommendations as to mandates in the former Ottoman lands and to find out what, quote unquote, the people wanted by way of mandatory rule. First the British and then the French declined to send representatives to this commission, correctly suspecting that such a commission might get in the way of agreements that they had made with each other during the war. Undeterred, President Wilson sent his own commission at the end of May 1919. Its co-chairs were Henry Churchill King and Charles Crane. Crane was an heir to a plumbing fortune. You know Crane toilets? Seriously, that was the Crane. And he actually sold his part of the business to his brother and became this kind of foreign policy entrepreneur. He was a big backer of Thomas Masaryk. And I think he did all sorts of things that would actually be illegal today, that private citizens aren't really allowed to mess with foreign policy. He was also a big campaign contributor to Wilson, was a big financial backer. Henry Churchill King was a national leader in reformist Protestant higher education, and as it happens, the president of Oberlin College. Neither had much knowledge in the Middle East, but in a way, were kind of chosen for that reason, that if you're going to do new diplomacy, you need new faces, faces unencumbered by prior knowledge. Well, the King Crane Commission it's true, it's true. Produced a very radical solution involving, get this, American mandates from Mesopotamia, what becomes Iraq, to Anatolia itself. So basically Baghdad to Constantinople. It was really kind of fanciful in that way. And it proposed this vast extension of American responsibilities in the world at precisely the moment this thing comes out, or it doesn't come out, it's presented to President Wilson, who is actually seriously ill by that time. It's presented at precisely the moment when American opinion is really souring on participation in the League of Nations at all. So the timing was not exquisite. And in some ways, the report is most interesting as an artifact of the Wilsonian imaginary and of how a kind of when the rubber of Wilsonianism hits the road. And it was actually a fascinating document from that point of view. Nevertheless, scholars of the Middle East remain very interested in the King Crane Commission report and still study it today. Its most famous and its most controversial conclusion was its four-square opposition to the establishment of a Jewish homeland or a Jewish state in Palestine. The argument was that you can only establish a Jewish state here at the point of a bayonet. Because there are too many people who live here who don't want massive Jewish migration here, which actually turned out to be true. Whether you think that's a good thing or whether you think that's a bad thing, I think it's true that Israel was established at the point of a bayonet. Okay, but scholars continue to be interested in the King Crane Commission in part for that reason. But in some ways it presents the same scenario as the French report. Throw out the Sykes-Picot Agreement, maximize Syria as a single mandate. So there's kind of a today-tomorrow aspect of it. Today, you create this large, geographically large Syria. Then you set about the task of creating Syrians. So you start with creating a large Syria and then go about the more mundane task of creating secular, liberal, democratic, tolerant Syrians. And there you have the sell-by date of the mandate. Syria becomes independent when you've created enough Syrians to run it, according to something very recognizable as a kind of an Anglo-American sort of civic identity for them. Okay. Now, it so happened that the Americans had no infrastructure for carding a commission around the Middle East at the time. There was no American military presence. Nor, in fact, was there much of a French military presence. Only the British had the machinery on the ground to get this commission to point A, to point B, point C. Guess what? At the end of the day, the commission pretty much saw what the British wanted it to see. And the British particularly wanted the commission to see Faisal. Okay? And so the commission came away with a very favorable impression of him indeed. And he becomes this kind of Arab George Washington. And so the proposal essentially calls for this Syria led by Faisal under an American mandate. Remember Faisal? I haven't talked about him much. Faisal is actually a good way to transition between what the idealists thought ought to happen and what actually did happen. Now Faisal, what did Faisal want? Faisal's plan A in the family tradition was the pan-Arab dream, this broad confederation of Arabic-speaking peoples from Mesopotamia to Morocco. Plan B was a greater Syria, that is, Roman and Ottoman Syria. Right? But Faisal also really liked the idea of being a king. He could talk the talk of Arab democracy, I guess sincerely. But his family, after all, these were the Hashemites. These people had been somebody under the Ottomans and very much wished to continue being somebodies. They were the descendants of the Prophet Muhammad. His father, Hussein, was religious leader. He was the emir of Mecca. And to keep being somebodies, Faisal was more than willing to deal with the British and particularly to take a great deal of British money over a great many years to see to it that he was king somewhere. So, but in a weird sort of way, so foredoomed and so bizarre a set of conclusions as those of the King Crane Commission were in some ways one of the few realistic solutions if the goal was the creation of a unitary Syria, either with or without Faisal. Junk the Sykes-Picot Agreement and somehow persuade, through calling in their war loans or something, persuading the British and the French to bequeath their claims in the region to a third party. And the Americans were the only people in the world, essentially, with enough potential muscle in the region to make it work. The King Crane recommendations, while very weird, in a way, this is a very French way of phrasing it, they're realistic in their weirdness. it's so out there that it actually begins to make a certain amount of sense. Well, of course, the bad news was that the British and the French were not going to give up their interest in the region. Both needed something to show for this awful war, which supposedly had ended in victory. The British government of India is very powerful, as keen as ever on protecting access to Suez. And to be fair, the British government took the Balfour Declaration seriously, and at least for a time, made a serious effort to make Palestine a going homeland for Jews. The British also knew where the oil was, that the oil was in Iraq and in the Arabian Peninsula, and were very interested in some sort of presence in the southern part of Ottoman Syria to secure access to it. The French, for darn sure, were not going to give up their claims in the northern part of Syria. Even more than the British, they needed something to show for the 1.4 million dead. Clemenceau politically fell, in 1920, and his successor was much more influenced by the colonial lobby. And so the borders were drawn. There we go. The borders were drawn. And Roman and Ottoman Syria came to be divided. In some ways, actually, not all that different from what the Sykes-Picot Agreement had provided for, except that Palestine was now a British mandate rather than internationalized. Henceforth, Syria, quote unquote, becomes French mandate Syria. Okay, more or less the boundaries of today's Syria. Syria is this mandatory Syria is then broken up into four quote-unquote states, two of them religiously based, a Druze state in the south, an Alawite state to the north and west, and separate states with capitals in the two largest cities, Damascus and Aleppo. And Lebanon was a separate mandate. Now, from the first days of their mandate in Syria to the last, right after World War II, the French insisted that they fulfilled the spirit as well as the letter of the mandate, that these entities, they swore hand on heart, were independent states. The French were just there to help until they could rule on their own. But the fact was, as I've said a couple of times, the French only knew how to run one kind of empire with bayonets and bureaucrats. In fact, the further division of Syria was standard issue divide and conquer politics, what the French called la politique des races, to divide up groups. Well, what became of Faisal? Remember Faisal? The French never had much use for him, always believing him, not completely inaccurately, as the creature of the British. After all, it was the name of the British that were on all those paychecks. But the French were willing to do business with him so long as he facilitated the establishment of the French mandate in Syria. The problem, though, is that it becomes increasingly clear that Faisal is actually not in charge in Syria. Okay? He was, after all, from Mecca. He was from another part of the Arabic world entirely. So the existing elite in Syria, the Ottoman-era elite of landowners and merchants, elects a Syrian National Assembly. In March 1920, that assembly pointedly rejected the division of Roman and Ottoman Syria, declared a Greater Syria with Faisal as its king, without, however, it seems, really confirming all this with him. This gives the French the pretext they need. They basically foreclose and occupy all of what will become Mandate Syria. And this kind of works because the post-Ottoman elite realizes that it can cut essentially the same deal with the French that it had with the Ottomans. So essentially it's the same group of people running the place, just under sort of different imperial management. Faisal is now unemployed. He eventually finds a new job as the British Mandate of Iraq and becomes the King of Iraq. He dies, he was a heavy smoker, he died of cancer in the 30s. His son becomes king, and his son is murdered in a coup in the 50s. His brother Abdullah becomes king of what becomes Jordan. And Abdullah is the grandfather of the present King of Jordan, whose name is also Abdullah. So that's what becomes of the Hashemites. And it took me years to understand this, but the full name of Jordan is the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan. And the Hashemite, it's the family, it's the royal house. Okay, what then, in conclusion, what is the takeaway of Syria as it's created as a consequence of the Great War? What does the then of the war in Syria tell us about the now, about Syria? So what, in other words? Well, I guess my first point is that modern Syria was born as the result of political geography. It was born as a result of a deal cut between the French and the British, a deal that said a lot more about the geopolitical identities of the French and the British than it did about the peoples who lived there. Now, of course, this wasn't the first time this had happened in the region. It's not like the Romans or the Ottomans took a poll and asked the peoples of the region who they wanted to rule them. The Romans and the Ottomans didn't really care. But now this mattered in a different way, because Syria, in quotes, wherever it was formally put on the path to independence, sanctioned by the League of Nations. The peoples who lived there never forgot this, even if the French and the British tried to. Second point. As a political construct, empires certainly create lots of problems, but sometimes they solve them too. Empires, as I've indicated, depend on difference that produces inequalities and hierarchies. But by definition, empires can be more comfortable with difference, be it religious difference, be it ethnic difference, be it linguistic difference, than nations. That's why they're empires and not nations. In nations, citizens are supposed to be more or less the same, politically speaking. Alawites, Druze, Shiites, Sunnis all get one vote each. So then the question becomes, how do you reconcile identity politics and liberal government? And isn't that a big question that goes way beyond Syria? How do you reconcile identity politics and liberal government? If you ask the people what they want, you can't really be sure what they're going to say. Ask people in England and Scotland this week. Right? If you ask people, you're not sure. And I must say, as a historian of France, it's fascinating to look at the referendum in Scotland. You know, Robespierre didn't do that sort of thing. There was the Republic, one and indivisible. And I was saying to a friend, what if we let Texas hold a referendum? I mean, you know, like, who's going to let that cat out of the bag? Republics don't let that cat out of the bag, because you can't be sure of what your answer is going to be. Okay. Well, my third point, if Syria and Lebanon were to become nations, on what would national sameness be based? Okay. If nationality is based on some kind of common denominator sameness, and Syria and Lebanon were to become nations, what would that sameness be based on? Well, for a time, it could be based on shared enmity toward the French. There were chronic and very serious rebellions against the French as early as 1925, and the Great War, truth be told, never really ended in Syria before World War II, and the French mandate kind of collapsed of its internal contradictions. Pandora's box had been opened. The peoples of Syria, in their diversity, had been told on the international stage that they had a right to self-determination. These rebellions were repressed with very familiar, what became sadly familiar, interwar tactics of military technologies such as planes and armored personnel carriers deployed in a self-conscious, unambiguous policy of terror. So that essentially it was the latest military technology aimed at civilians. But what happens, though, when the French are gone? Which leads me to my fourth point, which is that while the war after the Great War created Syria, it didn't really do a whole lot to create Syrians. And in a sense, the whole history of Syria ever since can be written around this effort to create Syrians. OK, Okay. And there were a whole series of attempts thereafter to figure out where Syria is and what Syrians are. Civilian attempts to establish a republic, there were military coups, there were various pan-Arabic solutions that were tried, such as in 1958, led by Nasser of Egypt, to create a pan-Arabic country, the United Arab Republic, which Syria joined for a time. There was even the Ba'ath movement, which was an attempt to create a secular, kind of, sort of, socialist political community, an effort to found a secular Syria. The problem, though, was that the Ba'ath Party in Syria, much like the Ba'ath Party in Iraq, became, in effect, a one-family dictatorship. Of course, in Syria, the first being Hafez al-Assad, now his son Bashar, the current unloved ruler of Syria. Turns out to be very difficult in the late 20th and early 21st centuries to create a national community based in a family dictatorship. It's not something that gets people to the barricades out of affection, I guess. I don't know what exactly motivates the Syrian army at the moment. That's another, we could talk about that. And in fact, ISIL seems to want to do away with the whole notion of Syria entirely. And certainly, you know, has essentially appropriated a part of Syria, which it now occupies. My fifth and most speculative point: would any of this have been different had some kind of Syrian unity been preserved after the Great War? Had the solutions proposed by the King Crane Commission, or even the French, had they been tried? Who knows? Would Syrians have created themselves spontaneously had they just been left alone? Had the Western powers picked up their military toys and gone back to Europe? Maybe so, maybe not. I guess the one thing I do know is that they were never really asked in the matter. And that's something that we've all been living with ever since. So with that, I will stop and thank you all for your attention. And I guess we have some time for questions. Okay. I'm sorry, let me show you one more map. I love this. This comes from the British Foreign Office, and the red area means advise against all travel. Good advice.
We have time for some questions. I can throw it to the audience.
Yes.
How about the question of getting the oil from the Mosul area
I think they're trouble about lots of things. I think the original deal was, because Mosul was originally in the French zone, according to the Sykes-Picot Agreement, and there are various versions. One version is that Clemenceau signed it away in hopes of better British guarantees in Europe before the peace conference even began, but that wasn't going to solve the problem of the pipeline. I don't actually know that much about the details, but there were chronic fights between the British and French the whole time, because essentially they divided Syria, this area that had been essentially one economic political entity since the Romans, is now being squabbled over between two kind of struggling imperial powers. The British had their own issues in Palestine. There were serious revolts in Palestine. They bought themselves a pack of trouble through the whole interwar period. And my understanding, I don't actually know that much about Palestine, but my understanding is that as Jewish immigration to Palestine continued, the situation became more and more dicey, and the British turned off the tap precisely when things in Europe were getting really, really bad. So which created then another level of tension there. The film Exodus, which I don't know, I used to think I could watch anything, but I couldn't make it to the end of that movie. I thought it was the most ridiculous thing I had ever seen, and at kind of just sort of not getting the kind of tension. And these Arabs were, oh, we love, like the more Jews, the better, they'll help us. And that was kind of the British argument at the time, is that massive Jewish immigration would help the Arab population because it would civilize these sort of unclean heathen and would help their economy and would help develop them, and it would all be great. And Faisal, to some extent, bought into this. I think Faisal was partly saying yes to his paymasters. I think partly, though, Faisal didn't get it. He didn't understand how many Jews of Europe, given the chance, would move to Palestine. I don't think he probably should have known, but he had no clue about kind of what kind of demographic shift he was potentially dealing with. And besides, he was unemployed by that time anyway. They packed him off to Iraq. First there. And here.
I wanted to ask you about your point on the mandates essentially being the doorstep to complicating or even ending empire. I get that is the theory. That's the best case scenario, but at least in terms of the British mandate, when they were talking about the sell-by date, if you will, there was never a date stamp. We're going to judge when these people are ready,
right.
and it was always, a century or more away. And we can keep moving that line if we need.
Right. What I think that's about is trying to square the circle. Susan Peterson wrote a really interesting article about Iraq in the last few years, and she argues that there's a historian currently writing a big history of the mandate. She's at Columbia, and her argument is that the British basically took the Iraqi mandate and then granted Iraqi independence for the same reason, that they were looking for a cost-effective way of securing this area geopolitically and getting the oil. They were looking for the least expensive way to do that. I guess where I come down all this, I just think that at the ideological level, the mandate by definition was a time bomb. And I think things like the British gyrations in Iraq or the French gyrations in Syria and Lebanon were an attempt to, I don't know, I mean, it becomes almost a game of let's pretend. Let's pretend that what's happening isn't happening, which is that we're not really in control of these areas. So I think the issue is how much of the glass do you want to consider full and how much of it do you want to consider empty? I guess in the case I'm making is that in agreeing to the concept of the mandate, they were agreeing that one day the glass was going to be empty and that they, the various gyrations didn't really do a whole lot to change that. So I think back there. Yeah. And then.
I tend to think that the world has no problems that can't be answered by the feminist papers. When we're first facing the problem, what's some are saying in Iraq from the book of that, I kind of took hope from the feminist.
I'm sorry, I'm a European historian by training. You have to tell me more what's in Federalist 10.
The idea that in a small state, you're going to have, in any state, you're going to have factions, let's say ethnic groups, and they're going to contend for power. And it's been thought that the smaller the state, the more likely self-government works. But Madison argued that if you have a really big state with a lot of different factions, no one can gain power, so they'll try to balance each other within some sort of checks and balances system. And I kind of hope that maybe that's the way it would work for Iraq and the Iraqi government ruined my plans, unfortunately. This question of how do you reconcile identity politics with democracy, this is something I struggle with. And I think this idea of finding some way to have a large state with a lot of factions in it, none of which can dominate the other, is the closest we can get. So I did like a large Syria. Who knows what could have worked? Do you have any thoughts that maybe there is a way, there could have been a way to make that workable? And is there any way to save Syria now?
Save Syria now. That's a very complicated question. In some ways, it's kind of two questions. I think one thing I should add to this, it's not like the Europeans worked this out. You know, the states, the successor states of Eastern Europe were very unstable and were just riven with ethnic hatreds and tensions, a lot of them anti-Semitic, and not just in Germany, in some ways, not even primarily in Germany, you know. And, I mean, essentially what happens in Europe is between Hitler and Stalin, the complicated ethnicity is brutally clarified. And, I mean, I guess I think one of the reasons Eastern Europe didn't go up in flames in after 1989 was that between Hitler and Stalin, the diversity was not remotely what it was at the beginning of the century. It was just a completely different demographic landscape. So it's not like the Arabic speaking peoples couldn't work this out, but the Europeans could. The Europeans couldn't work it out either. Is there anything to do about Syria at the moment? I guess I have to go into the realm of present day opinionated speculation, okay? Which is, I guess, that I'm one of the people who believes that ISIL, ISIS, whatever acronym you want, that's really, 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 really bad news. They're smart, they're rich, they're ruthless, and they govern territory, which Al Qaeda never really did, except for a few caves. You know, they're a very different sort of thing. They have to go. kind of, you know, I guess I almost think by any means necessary. And now I guess I'm kind of slipping into the not necessarily what I think should happen, but what I think is going to happen. I don't really see that happening unless we start looking the other way with Assad. You know, and he's a really wrong number, and I'm not going to defend him, not at all. I almost think the Israelis are hoping Assad wins at this point. You know, better the devil they know than the devil, or the worse than devil that they don't know. This Free Syrian Army thing, I mean, you know, most of them could fit in my house. I mean, you know, I just don't see them having the capacity to take on Assad and ISIL. I don't see what, I would love to be wrong, and historians are really, really bad predictors. So I would love, love, love to be wrong, but I don't see how that happens at this point. You know? So, I know this is what happens when historians start talking about the present. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is sort of a follow-up. What do we, meaning the U.S., do now in Syria, if anything?
Yep.
And the background question is, to what extent is oil still a factor?
Right. That's a good question. I live in Ohio, where there's a lot of fracking going on. And I think one of the interesting and not sufficiently commented on issues is the amount of domestic oil production in the U.S. is just skyrocketing. The amount of gas production, you know, I don't know, what if Rand Paul becomes a serious presidential candidate? Fine, let them kill each other. You know, we'll give Israel enough arms to defend itself and let the rest of them kill each other. We have enough oil. I think that's a possible scenario. You know, oil's too big a deal for it to go away soon. But I guess I, for one, will be very interested to see what happens in this country in you know, the day that we become self-sufficient in oil again, which hasn't happened for many decades. I don't know what that's going to be, but I just have to think that's going to change the equation. You know, I don't know how, but I don't see the United States giving up on Israel. I don't think that's going to happen, or that it should. But I'll be very interested to see just how this whole issue of the Middle East plays out if oil ceases to be an issue. Was that a vague enough answer to your question?
You know, I guess this may be related to what you're saying. And one of the things that's happening in Milwaukee now is that Wisconsin Electric is going to raise the rates on people who use solar panels.
Hmm.
So mm-hmm. the atmosphere is not great, it's not really supportive in terms of people being, you know, self-supporting with energy.
Right. I mean, I don't think it's solar. I think it's fracking. No, that's what's going to change the equation. No, and the results are really dramatic. And I have to tell you, you know, I don't know, is it oil here or is it gas? Like, how do people heat their homes in Wisconsin? Yeah. Is it gas? Yeah, we're gas too. My gas bill is halved. My gas bill is half what it used to be. You know, and I don't think I love fracking, but my gas bill is half what it used to be. And I noticed that, and boy, you know, I think my point is, venturing yet more deeply into the morass of a historian talking about present events, I think that the changing energy, domestic energy environment, is going to change how the Middle East plays out in this country in ways that you know, we can't foresee. I mean, another possibility that I could see is that ISIS uses its formidable financial resources and its bevy of people with Western passports, and some other really bad terrorist episode happens in this country, which I could see happening sometime in the next few years, which would be really scary. I'm kind of guessing if that happened, there'd be another invasion. And that would be, I just don't see a good outcome there too. But I imagine something that must be keeping the Homeland Security people up at night is, what are we gonna do if these people become seriously interested in some foreign terrorist act? And, you know, we know there are hundreds, maybe thousands, of people with Western passports, you know, working with them. What if they pull off something on the scale of 9/11 or bigger? You know, that's a very scary prospect. Yeah?
With the boundaries that were drawn for the internal states of Syria on the 1922 map, how were those determined? Was it based on the 1919 French map with all the colors and lines? Was that another artificial creation?
Right. My belief is that it was pretty artificial, because it doesn't actually correspond to where, you know, the Druze are strewn throughout the whole country. They were concentrated in that part, but there were Druze all over. They're like the Armenians. There were Armenians all over Anatolia, you know. And likewise, there were Alawites all through, you know, all over the place. So I suspect that probably military considerations had a lot to do with commanding strategic roads, commanding, you know, the heights. You know, my guess is that had a fair amount to do with it. And they had major cities. I mean, it was obviously they weren't going to put Aleppo and Damascus in the same jurisdiction. Yeah.
I don't know if any of my seminar students are here, but if they are, they should have read something about, which Tim McMahon probably knows about, my colleague, Churchill's HIPAA. Right? I'm sure that the story is probably not true, but after a sumptuous dinner that Churchill had, he began drawing the borders of Transjordan, and As he was, you know, drawing a line, he hiccuped. There was obviously a problem then with regard to the straight line.
I bet he was drunk.
It wasn't the sumptuous meal. It was the garden.
I'll believe anything. I didn't actually know the story of the Churchill hiccup, but it's conceivable to me.
But being a French historian, I mean, you certainly know how the French operate with borders. So.
Right. But they hold their liquor better. they don't hiccup.
I just wanted to point out also concerning mandate colonialism, which I agree with you. I think that the mandates should create a kind of a discrete colonialism. And what made it different too is that they had to supply the League of Nations in Geneva with yes. permanent mm-hmm. mandate reports.
Yeah.
So in other words, they have to kind mm-hmm. of let it out mm-hmm. in public, mm-hmm. Telling mm-hmm. the world what we've mm-hmm. done, where the problems are.
Right.
And that you know kind of makes it a little bit different too.
Sure.
Besides the mm-hmm. idea that they would, given their tutelage, they would let them go.
Right. Right. I'm going to talk about this a little bit more in the class tomorrow, but that the idea that the League of Nations was something fatally wounded at birth, and that's just not true, or that there was no way it could function as anything without the Americans being involved. That's just kind of American self-absorption, you know, just I'm at its worst. But the League is, I'll say this to this group, the League is undergoing a kind of cautious rehabilitation. As a forum for you know exchange and the construction of international norms, and of something that really did make a difference to people like refugees, when there were thousands in Europe after the war, and I don't know that I particularly have a position on that at the moment, but it's League of Nations is actually a reasonably hot topic at the moment, and people are taking another look at it. In three dimensions, not just as something that failed to prevent World War II. Which, of course, it didn't. No.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.